Hello. Hello. We're going to get started now. Yay! Yay! Everybody say electron transport. Yay! Okay. I am not with my child, so I will not talk to you like that.
Okay.
So, welcome back. There was a phone left last time, black case, iPhone, Nike on the back, with the data turned off. So find the phone didn't work. So if anybody found a phone, and hopefully you haven't sold it on eBay, please bring it up after class. Okay, so today we've set up a lot for this lecture, and I kept saying aerobic respiration. You guys are like, you're a liar, man. There's no oxygen here. Today is the day, man, that we're going to get some oxygen going. And so we're going to look at where this oxidative phosphorylation occurs, some cool similarities between mitochondria and bacteria, aerobic bacteria. We're going to be looking at the transfer of electrons. And we'll see little chains of molecules that are used to transport these electrons. You might imagine that there's some limitations to distances that an electron can just pass through space. And so there's strategic placement of electron carriers within some of the protons or proteins that you'll see today. And then we'll look at the way that we drive the formation of gradient of protons through the oxidation of NADH. And then we'll have some loose ends, and we'll do a summing up at the end to get a sense for, you know, how efficient aerobic respiration is. And so in the last two lectures, we've covered anaerobic respiration. Remember, the end product of that is an acid, lactic acid for us. But in the presence of oxygen, we are able to do a citric acid cycle, make lots of this NADH, and now we're at the stage where we've made some of these reduced cofactors and we need to do something with them. We need the currency of energy is not the oxidation of NADH, the currency of energy is ATP. And oxidation of NADH releases too much energy to be of general use across a variety of chemical transformations. We need smaller quanta of energy, so we're going to translate from this large amount of energy to a smaller amount, a hydrolysis of ATP. And so this all occurs in the mitochondria. I remember last time we were in the Krebs cycle in the mitochondria. Remember I mentioned this outer membrane is somewhat porous. Molecules 5 kD or less are able to simply diffuse through these pore-in channels. But then in the inner mitochondrial membrane, that is impermeable to protons and other metabolites. And so one of the important considerations today is that it not only takes energy to make ATP molecules, it also takes energy to move things into the appropriate place for us to do the reactions that we need to do. So in general, you can consider this inner membrane is impermeable to protons, but it's not absolutely perfect. That's very small percentage of protons can leak through there. And so when you look at mitochondria, it's like, dude, these look very similar. Their size is similar to a bacteria. They have both protein RNA encoding DNA. They have bacterial-sized ribosomes. So you'll learn in lecture 20 that in eukaryotes, our ribosomes are a little larger. But these bacteria have ribosomes that are perfectly functional, and they're 70S in size. And you also see these respiratory electron transport chains, you can find those in a variety of aerobic bacteria as well. And also this idea of coupling a gradient to synthesis of ATP, this chemiosmotic model, that's also seen in bacteria. And so this leads people to propose the following model where an aerobic bacteria infected some sort of primordial anaerobic eukaryotic cell. And these bacteria then became what we see today as mitochondria. But then also in plant cells, photosynthesis, one model of where that came from in plant cells is by infection of plant cells with a cyanobacterial photosynthetic bacteria. And so that conferred some of the useful abilities to perform photosynthesis. So this is just an amazing similarity and strongly held belief that these mitochondria that we see today are actually primordial aerobic bacteria. But they have changed over the eons, and we're going to study what they are today. And so this is the whole process. So what we're going to do here, remember we left the last lecture making NADH in the matrix. And this NADH needs to be reoxidized, right? So all those enzymes, those dehydrogenase enzymes that we've seen along the way will be of no use unless we have oxidized NAD so they can catch some more electrons. So what we're going to do today is transfer these electrons directly from NADH and from FADH2 into this electron transport. So there's four different complexes in this electron transport. You can see each of these, the pink arrows, you see the movement of protons from the matrix to the intermembrane space. Now, would you suppose that protons in the intermembrane space would stay necessarily in the intermembrane space? So what did I just say about that outer membrane? It's got big, fat holes in it. And so what we're really doing here is we're decreasing the concentration of protons in this matrix, right? So we're probably not affecting very much the pH outside of the matrix, right? Because that can easily exchange with the environment around the mitochondria. But we're creating a very low concentration of protons here, and that low concentration of protons and the movement of charged molecules in one direction, this electrogenic process, will generate the energy necessary to make ATP molecules. And so overall, you have the transfer of electrons starting from NADH ultimately being transferred through a series of these complexes and mobile electron carriers to an oxygen molecule, transforming that oxygen molecule four electrons at a time to water molecules. So that's the overall process here. And so if you look at the energy here, if you look at the redox potentials of NADH, or NAD and oxygen, you'll see this transfer of electrons is highly exergonic. If you do the calculations, remember we set this up in an earlier lecture, you get 220 kilojoules per mole. And you guys remember ATP synthesis, that only takes maybe 30 kilojoules per mole. You know, if you consider delta G, maybe up to 50 kilojoules per mole, because there's a higher concentration of ATP than ADP. It's about 10 to 1. And so really, what we want to do is catch this energy. So obviously, we're going to need to make more than one ATP molecule per NADH. And this might have evolved to just be a direct process. You have some magical enzyme that oxidizes NADH to NAD and somehow is able to catch that energy, hold it for a while, and then convert multiple ADP molecules to ATP. But that's not how it evolved. It works through these gradients. So there's a lot of energy here. So potentially, if this was absolutely 100% efficient, you can make potentially 7 moles of ATP from that 1 mole of NADH oxidation. And so if you look here, you look at the pink arrows, you see that a total of 10 protons are transferred per NADH molecule oxidized. Okay, but remember this molecule, what's the name of this enzyme? Does anybody remember? This was in Krebs cycle, this enzyme. Remember towards like the bottom 7 o'clock position in the circle? Remember that? Succinate, it's transferring electrons, so it actually is a real dehydrogenase, right? And so that comes in at a later stage. So the FADH2 results, the oxidation of that results in only 6 protons being transferred because it bypasses complex 1, right? But the FADH2, those 2 protons, as you'll see, combine here and come out over here, right? And so you'll see an example of this coming up. Okay. And so if you do this stoichiometry, of course, we're making water molecules from oxygen molecules, so we need some hydrogens there. So we're taking for NAD and moving 10 moles per mole of NADH. And so here we've labeled this intermembrane space in the matrix with an N side and a P side. What might you guess that means? N and P? Just give it a guess. It's actually not written on a slide. What might it be? We're moving a charged proton. Yeah, let it rip, man. So there's a positive charge here. There's accumulation of charge. And so we can use this gradient of both molecules and charge to drive the processes that we want to drive, ATP synthesis and the movement of metabolites across this membrane. Okay, and so I'm not going to go, this is the exact same slide that I showed you before, and I'm just highlighting here again that there's two components, the movement of these protons. We're building up a gradient of molecules and also a gradient of charge, and both of those help the process to be more exergonic when you move molecules back into the matrix, especially if they're positively charged molecules, okay, or move negative charge net out of the mitochondria. And so this is the overall process. So when we think about the movement of protons, oftentimes you think about pH. Now, pH is not a natural log, right? pH is a log base 10. So we can take that original equation and convert it. So if you look up in textbooks, you can see that you can express this as log base 10 if you just multiply by 2.3. So for every certain amount of change in pH, that's going to affect how exergonic this is. And so we're looking at the difference in pH between the negative side and the positive side. Okay, and so we're moving charged molecules, accumulating them on this positive side. Okay, and so if you do all these calculations and you do some measurements, a lot of times they use pH-sensitive dyes that they load in the mitochondria so they can actually directly measure pH changes. You see that this gradient that's formed by electron transport is about a change of pH about 0.75 pH units. And if you do the calculation, that's equivalent. So each mole of a proton or across gives you about 20 kilojoules of energy, right? So that's a little bit less than we need for ATP. So obviously, when we're synthesizing ATP, we're going to have to move more than one proton. So NADH, let's recap, moves 10 protons. FADH moves 6, right? But if we move one of those protons back, that's not enough to make ATP. So we're actually going to have to move, as it turns out, 2.5 protons. Okay, and so, yep. So this is where we are right now. So what we're going to do is go through this, or not. Let me just reconnect real quick. Yay. Okay, so what we're going to do is an actual electron transport chain, and that the magnetism that we're going to apply to move electrons is this electron affinity. Remember when we talked earlier about these redox potentials? I said you could also think of this table in terms of the affinity of each of these molecules for electrons. So the highest affinity for electrons is going to be the molecule that is the final resting place of the electrons. Makes sense. But you can see electrons are going to be passed from one of these molecules to another. Now, these are the redox potentials of various prosthetic groups that we'll see today in solution. Now, the protein can modulate these things, but the general process is each hop that an electron takes, it's moving to a position of higher affinity. And you can see this last hop generates a lot of, there's a big delta here. And so that's actually going to be used to also push the movement of some more protons in that last step. We'll see that at the end. So here is the process. There's lots of cofactors. We have the proteins. We have this QH2 molecule. And so that's lipophilic. It drifts around in the membrane, carrying two electrons at a time between complexes. Okay, and we've already seen FAD. Remember our succinate dehydrogenase. This is actually a 1 or a 2 electron carrier. But remember, for succinate dehydrogenase, it accepted 2 electrons. And so these are our one of our electron carriers. But the electron transport chains are not just these heme-type prosthetic groups. They're also complexes of metal ions. So we'll see metal and copper. So copper is useful to store energy. Iron here is useful to transfer these electrons. And these, we remember in Econotase, we saw another example of this, of clusters of metal ions. In that case, it was more to provide that specific transformation. Chemical transformation. But here, when you have a complex of metal ions, in general, the way nature has engineered this, only one of these metal ions is going to be changing oxidation state. The other metal ions are precisely coordinating the position, because the distance between where electrons are being transferred for is very, very important. But also, these other metal ions are affecting the redox potential. Everything is exactly precisely tuned so that every hop you're going to a higher electron affinity center. Okay, and so here's an example where you have 4 iron atoms and only one goes to the oxidized state. Okay, this is our mobile electron carrier. You can see it's very lipophilic, so we have 10 of these isoprene units. You guys now are very aware of the structure of isoprene. And so this is attached to a functional group, this quinone. This quinone can be reduced by one electron to the semi-quinone. We'll actually see that today. But also can have a 2-electron reduction to the ubiquinol form. Okay, and so we abbreviate, from now on, I'll just say Q, QH, and QH2. These are the different reduction states of this carrier. And this thing just moves around in the bilayer. Here's the structure of some of the heme groups. Remember, some of the electrons are carried on heme groups, others are carried on actual just coordinated metal ions, such as iron and copper. And these also have tuned their electron affinity, so this is increasing affinity here. So low, higher, higher. And so each of these is our prosthetic group. So they're held tightly within the enzyme active site. And actually, remember when we saw heme before in myoglobin, we had one histidine on one side and then the other side bound oxygen. Actually, these hemes, as they sit in the proteins you'll see today, both sides are protected because we don't want to carry an oxygen molecule here. We just want to have these change their reduction state. And so, you know, we want to control their environment very precisely by actually ligating both sides of the iron. Any questions so far? All right, so each of these complexes, complex 1, 2, 3, and 4, has an assortment of different polypeptides. So for example, complex 1 has 43 different subunits. It has a variety of different prosthetic groups that are involved in the electron transport. We've already seen succinate dehydrogenase. Remember, we saw FAD. Our electrons are actually waiting for us from the last lecture, sitting on FAD as FADH2 on that protein. And so some of these are just, you know, huge. They're almost a megadalton in size if you look at the aggregate molecular weight. One tidbit of information that might not be too surprising to you, that each of you might think, okay, well, this is very precise. We've got to transfer electrons. But the efficiency of each of these is not identical. So the kcat over km is not identical for all of these. So for the ones that are a little bit slower, a little less efficient, we're going to need a higher abundance of those complexes. So there's all of these complexes are not in the same amount, but they're in the perfect amount so that there's enough of them when you figure their catalytic efficiency. Okay, so that's a little tidbit to throw in. Okay, so we're going to just go through these one at a time. So complex 1 is responsible for moving 4 protons from the matrix to the intermembrane space. And then 2 of these protons are also strategically being taken up from the matrix. This enzyme could have pulled them out from here, but that would be counterproductive. So the 2 protons are taken up from here and then loaded onto our reduced QH2 lipophilic mobile carrier. And so here is NAD. This is backwards, isn't it? Yeah, this is backwards. Could you correct your slides, please? So we're taking electrons. This one doesn't have much left to give. I never caught that. But look at this. See the electrons? It's like this strategically placed gauntlet of different iron sulfur complexes in this FMN. Remember, FMN is the head group of the FAD molecule, right? So it's not it's a mononucleotide. But that thing is just sitting there as a prosthetic group. Electrons are passed from one to the next according to electron affinity, ultimately being deposited on ubiquinone there. And so, yep. And so we're converting this hydrophilic carrier, NADH, to a hydrophobic carrier. So after this process, the electrons end up on a hydrophobic carrier. And so four protons go there and two go here. And so let's look at this. So let's think about the logic here. There's a linear relationship between the log of the rate of the transfer of the electron and the distance in each hop, right? So if you had the total distance here is 74 angstroms. And so if you look on this handy dandy plot, 74 angstroms, it's just not going to happen. You need to transfer these, you know, the way it works in nature, it's about, I guess, 10 angstroms, 7 angstroms each hop, right? So it's not perfect, but it's, you know, this is what is necessary to move the electrons through here. And so this movement of electrons and the deposition of those electrons on our mobile electron carrier, the Q molecule, coenzyme Q, is going to cause a conformational change. And so some of that energy used to move these electrons is going to cause a kick in this whole complex. Remember, there's a large number of polypeptides here. And so this is actually a brand new, hot off the presses. This is the structure, crystal structure of the bacterial complex one. And so it sort of looks upside down because bacteria do their electron transport in a confusing way. But the assumption is that the eukaryotic complex one structure is going to be very similar. And so here you can see there's a variety. So this is the actual membrane. And so throughout here, you have a bunch of helices spanning this membrane. But then you have this oddly placed shaft here. So you have this one long helix that is touching all of these different polypeptides in this part of the protein. And so the protons are going to make their way through here. And so there's a total of 1, 2, 3, 4 different channels. So you can see that along where these protons are, there's these hydrophilic pathways. So you can imagine that a lot of the axial amino acids on these alpha helices are going to be hydrophobic because this thing's sitting in a bilayer. But they have these hydrophilic pathways. The other cool thing that's going on here is there's this shaft of hydrophilic amino acids that goes all the way down, alternating charge. And so this is linking all of these complexes together. So you have both a helix, a structural link between all these different polypeptides, but you also have this, this, I guess you could say, a salt bridge. So it's a long chain of oddly, I mean, you wouldn't expect in the middle of a bilayer to have all these hydrophilic amino acids. But this is useful because these are the things that are going to pull and push here. And so when we transfer an electron, that causes the change of shape of this ubiquinone to ubiquinol, the reduced form, shifts all of these things, causing these transporters to change their conformation. So here you have, when you don't have molecules bound, you're open to, in our case, it would be the matrix in eukaryotic cells. And then when you reduce the molecule, the thing pushes using this shaft of all these polar amino acids in this helix and changes the conformation here, right? Moving it so that you release the molecules of protons on the other side. In our case, it would be going to the intermembrane space. So it's coordinate movement. It's sort of like rowing teams. So some members of the Brown crew team here, and they can tell you all about how you have to be in perfect unison, right, to make this the most efficient. And so there's structural features that help us to do that. It's really cool stuff. Okay, so now if we come in at complex 2, we bypass the movement of these 4 protons, right? And so let's look at that complex 2 real quick. So remember, this is succinate dehydrogenase. It really is dehydrogenating its substrates. You're forming a double bond, not in this case a new bond to oxygen. Any questions so far? I'm just sort of blazing a trail. Questions? All right. So we left our electrons in this citric acid cycle on FADH2. And so what we're going to do here is transfer those up to the same lipophilic carrier. This QH2 molecule is going to be the final resting place. And so here's our FAD. Remember, I left our electrons there in citric acid cycle. And then those are, as soon as they come off in the citric acid cycle, they're immediately transferred up into this QH2 molecule. And so this also has lots of different, and same sort of idea. You have a series of electron centers that can transfer and minimize the distance that the electron has to hop. Okay, and so we end up moving 4 less protons. Okay, so now we've got all of our electrons on QH2, and now we need to go into complex 3. Now, complex 3 is confusing because complex 3 is translating languages. It's translating from the 2-electron language of QH2, right, to the 1-electron language of cytochrome C. So as it turns out, the next carrier for electrons cannot accept 2 electrons at a time. It has to accept just 1. But we need, you know, so we're coming in with 2, and these are hot potatoes, right? You can't just sort of let the electrons float in space. They would immediately be dissipated. So we need a safe place to store our electrons here so that we can translate and get 1 electron up to cytochrome C. So obviously, for each QH2 that comes in, we're going to have 2 cytochrome Cs in the reduced form coming out, right? Electrons are not disappearing in this process. So, and then cytochrome C is the next thing, but it can only accept 1 electron at a time. And then cytochrome C is actually a protein that's floating around in the inner membrane. It's bigger than 5 kilodaltons, so it doesn't get out through those porins, but it's able to fuse there. It's nice to have this mobile proton carrier that's floating around because it helps to buffer. So if there's rapid changes in the arrival of substrate in ADH, this thing, you can have a little bit of buffering capacity, right? So if everything was a one-to-one linkage, then that flexibility wouldn't be available. So let's look at QH2. So this is something called the Q cycle. And so we have QH2. Remember, QH2 could have come from complex 1 or complex 2. Remember, both of those make a QH2 molecule. Now, when this 2-electron carrier arrives at complex 3, one of the electrons does what you might guess. It goes right onto cytochrome C, which is waiting there. And that binding of the electron by cytochrome C induces a conformational change, causing cytochrome C to be released from complex 3. But the other electron binds to another oxidized Q molecule. Okay, and so the input here is QH2, reduced form, and an oxidized form. Okay, and so this single electron, that's why it's cool that this thing can carry, it doesn't have to carry 2 electrons at a time, it can carry 1 electron. So it's a safe, it's the semiquinone form of the molecule, and this is somewhat energized, but it's a safe place to store electrons instead of just having it sitting around, floating around in space. So we have the semiquinone of the Q molecule, coenzyme Q, and it's storing our electron. So now, this is good, but you know, we need to figure this out. Like, so we need to actually move another electron here. We got to get this electron off of the Q molecule and put it back up here. And you might guess what would happen next. It's somewhat logical. You have a second QH2 molecule come in, and that QH2 molecule is going to do the exact same thing, same movement of electrons. 1 electron goes to a second cytochrome C molecule, converting it from its oxidized to reduced form. And the other electron is going to go to the semiquinone that's storing our first electron. So now we've generated another QH2 molecule. But again, we're strategically taking the protons necessary here from the matrix. So this is not a direct transport of a proton across the body. Remember, complex one, we have the seesawing of an actual transporter molecule. Here, we're grabbing, strategically grabbing protons from the matrix, carrying them on QH2, and then eventually releasing those protons. So here you can see there's two protons coming out. But these came from these QH2 is QH2, right? So we can't tell if it's something that was made by complex 3, complex 1, or complex 2. It's a whole gamish, right? And so, but this is the net process. So let's look at the overall process. So you have a QH2 and a Q come in, split the electron 1 up, 1 to make the semiquinone, and then you have a second QH2 come in, you fully reduce the semiquinone to a QH2, and the other electron goes to a second cytochrome C molecule. So we've now translated through the Q cycle a 2-electron carrier into a 1-electron carrier. Okay, you with me so far? Q cycle's a bit confusing. Yes, it is. No questions. You understand? Or is it just too painful? All right. So we're going to move on. Okay. So the last step, well, here's the aerobic respiration part. Here's the oxygen molecule. So oxygen is relatively able to pass through a membrane. So we have some amount of oxygen in the membrane. The structural, this is drawn in cartoon form because we really don't have an X-ray crystal structure yet that's very good for this. But so the general thought is the oxygen molecule comes in here. But here we have another translation problem. So we have our one electron carrier arriving, cytochrome C docks like a space, you know, lunar lander, lands on a complex four, but it's just, it's insufficient to provide all the electrons for this four electron reduction of oxygen, so it delivers just one electron. So we need a battery, right? A copper top. Here is a copper atom that's waiting, and this copper atom, when it becomes reduced, is still pretty stable, and it's able to store some of these electrons. There's actually a little tyrosine residue as well from one of these polypeptides, and that tyrosine can become a tyrosyl radical. And it's sort of safe to put your radicals on something that's covalently attached to a tyrosine or to the polypeptide, because then you're not going to tend to release it. So this is a very complex process. You can read about all the details online or in your textbook. But the net idea here is let's store up and wait till we get all four electrons. So that means the docking, the lunar landing of four total cytochrome C molecules, and transfer those electrons, storage on these copper atoms in these prosthetic groups. And then all at once, in a process that we don't fully understand yet exactly, like how does it know when it has four? Well, you'd imagine that the changing the redox state of some of these metals might change the structure. And so perhaps the binding, this is just pure speculation, perhaps the binding of oxygen can only happen through the allosteric changes that occur when these copper ions change their oxidation state. So then you bind oxygen and in one fell swoop transfer all four of those electrons to oxygen and also transport four protons across here. So remember that last hop in our redox potential table is like 0.5 difference between like the last one, which is here, and oxygen. So there's a large amount of energy here. It's enough to drive four protons across here. Okay, but the final resting place of our electrons, starting from NADH, was to land on oxygen. They're sitting out here in water molecules. Okay, and so we've transformed the chemical energy of the non-aromatic reduced form of NADH and FADH2 to a gradient. And so it took energy to make that gradient, Right, so we have a positive charge accumulating on the outside of this bilayer, and you have a higher concentration of protons, or you could consider it as a lower concentration of protons in the matrix. And now we're just going to use transport in reverse to make our ATP molecules. Does this make sense so far? Cool. Wow. So you might wonder why. You just made this stuff up, dude. Where did it come from? So these are actual experiments where people were able to figure out, you know, one of the general questions is, okay, I know there's a lot of different prosthetic groups. What is the order of things? Like, so here we know the rule is an electron's only going to make that hop if it's going to an electron carrier that has higher affinity. But, you know, one necessary thing to understand the process is to say, okay, what direction are these hops going in? And so you can add inhibitors to different complexes, right? So here we have an inhibitor complex 1, and then you can look at the oxidation state of each of these prosthetic groups. So you can disrupt the protein using harsh conditions, biochemically enrich for each of these prosthetic groups, and then use spectroscopy to be able to measure their oxidation states. Because when these prosthetic groups change oxidation state, you have a different set of absorbances show up. So you can differentiate for each purified prosthetic group, the actual whether it's oxidized or reduced. And so if you add the inhibitor, that says, okay, well, NADH comes before all of these other things. You say, okay, that was not that shocking. Antimyosin A turns out to inhibit complex 3, and so that told them that these factors can come before complex 3. And then cyanide and carbon monoxide inhibit complex 4, and so they found, oh man, all of our cofactors are reduced. Can you guess what the mechanism of this inhibition might be? So we learned some terms to describe inhibition when we thought about Michaelis-Menten. What might you guess, just looking at these inhibitors, what kind of inhibitors might they be? Competitive, right? So they structurally look very, very similar, right? So carbon monoxide, carbon monoxide and cyanide are literally competing for binding of oxygen on complex 4. Right, so these are just awful poisons, and so all of this, the whole electron transport will be shut off when we inhibit this complex 4. These are competitive inhibitors to the binding of oxygen to complex 4. So this is the type of way before, because you know, these are not easy. I mean, they're 1 megadalton, it takes a long time to get the structures. We don't have the structures of any of the eukaryotic proteins, yes, just the prokaryotic proteins. And so while we're waiting for those structures to be solved, we can figure out the order of prosthetic groups. And so this is an illustration of how these electron carriers change absorbances when they oscillate between the oxidized and reduced form. So that's how the last experiment they were able to tell which molecules are oxidized, which molecules are reduced. Okay. And so we have a lot of energy built up here. We've transferred this chemical energy, and you can actually do some calculations using our equation. And so you can look, I think the next slide are coming up eventually, you can actually calculate how much energy has been stored in this disequilibrium of both charge and protons. Okay, and so we have both the chemical potential being stored up, the aggregation of protons or the disaggregation of protons in the matrix, because the matrix now has a very low amount of protons. We also have this charge, so we can literally plug our USB cable directly into the membrane and tap out some of that energy. Okay, so this is electron transport. Any questions on that so far? Anything, Alex, in the forum, the monitor?
Yeah, one about cytochrome C and complex BC1.
Could you start again? I could.
There's one question about cytochrome C and complex BC1.
Yeah.
What causes the cytochrome C to bind to the third complex?
It just has a set of cognate amino acids. So there's a surface on the cytochrome C, and it has a distribution of most likely positive and negative charges, as well as hydrophilic groups, that causes a complementary binding on the complex. So it's just a protein-protein interaction. But the change in the oxidation state causes cytochrome C to rearrange some of those amino acids and then be released.
And then second question, why are four protons taken from the negative side if only one QH2 is formed for every QH2 coming into complex three?
Okay, so it is a confusing figure. So we'll go through this one more time. Okay. So the question is four overall. Where are the other two coming from in the matrix? What do you guys think? So here you're like, okay. So the overall summary is here, right? So we got two protons actually literally being grabbed from the matrix. Where are the other two protons coming from? Four coming out, two coming in, man. I'm not a genius, but that doesn't add up. I'm not that smart. So they're coming from somewhere else, either from here or from here, right? So you could add two protons here, because remember, what is succinate? You're actually removing two protons from the succinate molecule to make a doubly bonded fumarate. So there's some protons, or here, in this complex, we're taking those protons. So the same complex doesn't pick up the two of those protons as the other. So the other complex, you have two protons here, two protons here, and those end up being two of the protons coming out. It's a little confusing. I totally agree. Sorry that nature made it confusing. Does that make sense now? Okay. So this is, so now we've built up a huge amount of energy in this gradient. And we're going to use this ATP synthase to be able to transform that gradient energy, right? So this energy of the non-electrogenic transport of protons. And we're going to use that to drive the synthesis of ATP molecules. So this is the F0, F1 ATP synthase. So this is the F0 part. Down here, it's the part in the membrane, and this is the F1 part up here, and it literally is a rotating molecule. So this part in the membrane has these C subunits. These things rotate. So as protons come in, they hitch a ride on aspartic acid, I believe, amino acid, yep, aspartic acid. And as they ride, that drives the rotation of this whole thing. It's a cylinder rotating in the membrane. Isn't it amazing? And then you have this gamma subunit, and that's attached to the rotating cylinder. So the protons are pushing as, there's a lot of gradient here. There's a lot of energy of this protons coming back down across. So here it's upside down, right? So here's the matrix, and here's where our protons are accumulated. And so that high concentration of protons is pushing this whole thing to rotate. And this thing is attached, the C subunits are attached to the gamma subunit. And this gamma subunit is a camshaft thing. And so the gamma subunit turns while this beta subunit is holding this whole top steady. So if the whole thing just turned, you wouldn't be able to harness energy. So if this whole top and bottom, everything turned, you know, there would be no energy being used here. It would just be rotating. Be fun to look at, right? And so, but what we want to do is drive the synthesis of ATP from ADP and phosphate. And so that synthesis occurs on these beta. So there's three beta subunits, which are the subunits that synthesize ATP. The alpha subunits confusingly can bind ATP, but they cannot, or ADP, but they cannot synthesize. They're non-catalytic. The alpha subunits just help to position the beta subunits. Okay, and so this is steady. This thing is sort of holding, it's a stator. This is just like you'd see in an engine, this stator. And the camshaft is rotating, and it's bonking each of these subunits. So the gamma subunit is sort of like a wedge. And as it rotates, it bonks each subunit. So there's something that, this has been engineered so that to kick things out, right? Because it's the rotation causes this non-cylindrical thing up in here to hit each of the subunits. And so one of the earliest experiments they did, they wanted to figure out, say, how exactly is ATP being synthesized here? One possibility, probably I would have guessed the possibility a lot of people were going for, was that, well, each of these beta subunits probably does its conformational thing, right, changing shape, and simultaneously and independently synthesize ATP. But then they did a very simple experiment where they lopped off the top part of this. So as it turns out, this is an enzyme that catalyzes ATP synthesis, but when you cut off the top part, it's able to hydrolyze ATP. It's able to work in reverse. And so when they did this experiment, when you think about a hydrolysis reaction, there should be one oxygen attached to your hydrolysis product, this phosphate, that is coming from a water molecule. And so they're saying, okay, this is sort of a waste of time, everybody. Everybody knows when we do this experiment, hydrolyzing ATP, we're going to get this inorganic phosphate, and only one of the oxygen atoms are going to be labeled. So why are you wasting our time? But the intrepid graduate student that did this is just like, dudes, they're all labeled. And this was shocking. When you think about ATP hydrolysis, what does this tell you about the thermodynamics of ATP hydrolysis in this enzyme? It's very surprising. What does it tell you about equilibrium? Think about, so how many, what is the standard change of free energy of hydrolysis of ATP? 30 kilojoules per mole. So should that be easily reversed? So they're like, dude, this thing, they're all labeled. There's an equilibrium. You know, up to the point of synthesis of ATP, or transformation between ATP and ADP, this thing is basically binding, being transformed, coming off, binding, coming off, binding, coming off. And that's weird. They're like, well, wait a minute. It should be, it's hydrolyzed. It's lost so much free energy that there's not enough energy to go go for another round. And so what this suggested is a shocking free energy profile. So here we have the expected free energy profile. And they saw ADP is a lot less free energy than ATP, and hydrolysis should be a one-way street. There shouldn't be an equilibrium. Only one of those oxygens should be labeled. But this result told them, well, there is an equilibrium between the enzyme-bound ADP and inorganic phosphate and the enzyme-bound ATP. They have delta G. It must necessarily be approaching zero because you have labeling throughout, which means this thing comes off and on, and all of the oxygens get labeled eventually. And so what this experiment told them is that the energy-requiring step that this enzyme has designed is the kicking out of the phosphate. So you can think of this as Das Boot, right? So it just kicks out the phosphate. And that, and so if this is greatly stabilized, how would an enzyme stabilize a substrate? By making tons of bonds to the ATP molecule, many more bonds to ATP than to ADP. So it binds it very tightly. It's like, dude, I like my ATP. You can't have it. And so what this camshaft is doing is it's providing the boot, and it's kicking out the ATP molecules, right? And so that's what you can think about the affinity here. It turns out that the F1 subunit binds with this insanely high affinity to ATP compared to ADP, right? And so that's because there's just more bonds to that last phosphate. There's all kinds of coordination going on there. And so that provides you an ability to make the, or to have the kicking out of the ATP be the energy requiring step. And they did one more experiment. So there's still this question, okay, is it the, are all these beta subunits independently synthesizing ATP, or is there some kind of coordination as the camshaft rotates around? In other words, does the camshaft have three blades or one blade that bumps the subunits? And they didn't need a structure to figure this out. So what they did is they threw in a non-hydrolyzable analog of ATP. So it has this amino group where in this phosphoanhydride position that normally would have been an oxygen. And so they stuck this in here. And what they found is that this analog if each subunit was acting independently and the kicking out of the ATP is the hard step, the expectation would be, okay, all three of these subunits should have this inhibitor. So this is going to block, you know, block this process. And so all three should have this inhibitor if each one is acting independently. But then they got the crystal structure and they say, okay, no. We have one of the three subunits has an ATP, the other subunit has ADP and phosphate, and the other subunit is empty. And they said, the camshaft has one knob on it. So this is the structure they got. They had one subunit. They're all sort of changes in conformation illustrated with these different circles. So this is one conformational state. This is another conformational state. This is a third conformational state. So they found this inhibitor was only in one position. When they inhibited one position, the other positions were not able to just, you know, also have a analog, ATP analog there. And so they found ATP here, they found an ADP binding site, and they found an empty site. Okay, and so this led them to the current working model. This is a little confusing. You might want to enlarge these arrows because it's sort of important. So this is the camshaft. So this is what a camshaft is. It has a round thing, and every once in a while it has a knob. Remember, this is like a pencil pointing up through the donut of that F1 subunit. This pencil has a knob on one side. So every time it rotates, every 120 degrees, that knob is going to contact the beta subunit and literally kick the ATP molecule out. So let's start from here and watch this. So here we have the gamma subunit, the camshaft is pointing here. That kicks an ATP out. But then as this thing is rotating, this is rotating this case in counterclockwise fashion, so when it moves to the next position, it kicks that out. It actually has like some amino acids there that just crunch against that subunit and have it change its conformation, kicking ATP out. And then you rotate again. Again, we're rotating counterclockwise. We're looking, this is the top of the F1 subunit. We're looking down the shaft of the gamma, and this is the little camshafty part of the gamma subunit. So you rotate to here, it kicks it out. Okay, and so each, and people have done a lot of work trying to study the stoichiometry here, and they found for each movement, three protons. So every ATP molecule that's synthesized, three protons need to be dissipated through the gradient. Now, this totally depends on the type of organism you're working with. You can imagine the exact lipid composition might affect the what percent of protons are just able to dissipate. So certain lipids, perhaps the protons can. So this is a general ballpark estimate. It takes about three protons moving down their electrochemical gradient to move this camshaft by 120 degrees. So this is like a nice model, but they actually took a movie. In this movie, they could actually see the thing turn 120, stop, stop, stop. I mean, it's just, so these dudes in Japan like hooked up some actin to these subunits, flipped them upside down, and had this actin fluorescent whip going in circles. Right, and so each, yeah, so this sort of summarizes everything we've seen so far. This thing, this camshaft is rotating, kicking it out. Every 120 degrees, it kicks out an ATP. Look at this insane experiment. So they separated this F1 complex. They put what's called a His tag. Some of you have done some of these type of experiments where they put a tag on these beta subunits, and they put a nickel-coated plate. And so the His tags, this thing landed upside down, right? So it can go in the opposite direction. Remember, it can make ATP or it can hydrolyze ATP. In this case, they were looking at ATP hydrolysis. So they put this thing upside down on a cover slip and literally attached a whip to it on this side of the molecule. They had another tag on the C subunits, and the biotin made specific interactions with avitin-labeled actin that had a fluorescent tag. And so they're going to actually watch this thing. This is making new strong bonds here. So now this thing, as it rotates, it's just going to whip around, right? So here's a movie, 120, 120. I mean, it's like some, there it is, dude. These things get biochemists quite excited. But it stops. I mean, it's, you know, it's sort of, it's not exactly perfect. In nature, you don't have a whip going around. Another question that comes up often is, like, how fast is the rate? I don't know. It's probably pretty damn fast. But it literally, every time it stops, that's when it's like, get out. It's kicking out ATP molecules. So there's direct experimental evidence of this mechanistic hypothesis. So here in the next movie, you can look at the, we saw this in the first lecture, you can look at the conformational changes that are occurring here. And so see as that thing rotates, see how everything is like moving around? So look, here comes the phosphate and the ADP. Look at all those bonds to the ATP. It's like grabbing it. And then that camshaft comes around and changes all of those amino acids and kicks it out. So literally, and see how this side thing is holding it in place, preventing the top from rotating? It's a little engine. And this is how the majority of ATP is made in your cell. Sorry. Excuse my excitement. Okay. All right, so let's do an accounting of costs here. So far, we've transferred, remember, 10 moles of protons per mole of NADH molecules, or 6 moles of protons for FADH for 1 mole of FADH2. And then we saw, I showed you that it takes 3 protons to make 1 ATP molecule. But there's other things we have to do. So we need another proton to transport molecules across the bilayer. Right? So remember, we're using, where did we use the, you've already seen us use a proton gradient to transport a molecule. Do you remember where? Drink. Pyruvate. So the movement of pyruvate was driven by protons. What else might you have to be moving across bilayers to synthesize ATP? Inorganic phosphate and ADP have to come into the matrix, and ATP has to come out. That takes energy. You're crossing a bilayer. And so a total, on average, it takes about 4 moles of protons to make an ATP molecule. And so if you calculate that up, 4 mole of protons, that comes out to about 80 kilojoules. That's way more than enough to make an ATP. Now, ATP is usually about tenfold higher concentration than ADP. So in terms of the cellular state change in free energy, it's around 50. Right, but so this is, you know, up to the point of transport of protons across the bilayer is about 90% efficient, but then in the synthesis of ATP, it's about 38% efficient. And you say, well, where did the rest of it go? Made heat, right? So if it's not making molecules, it's making heat. Okay, and so you are a warm-blooded person. The heat that warms your body up is the excess from this process, right? So this keeps your core nice and toasty. You have a nice layer of fat, at least in case of the professor. Keep all that heat on the inside. But if you're a bear, you need a little bit more heat. Say you're just sitting in your cave, right? Nice bear. You're sitting there and you're having nice dreams. Can you imagine sleeping for all winter? It'd be better than teaching, I think, or taking exams. So the bear has to tap into this heat. So one of the reasons evolutionarily that, you know, it wasn't a direct conversion of NADH to ATP is because we can also use heat. And so bears, they uncouple their respiration. So they have this uncoupling protein, thermogenin, are little babies. They have this brown fat. That brown fat expresses some of this protein, which allows protons to come back down the gradient. Right, so they have a futile cycle of protons. Oxidation of pyruvate, just like burning a tree, generates heat. Right, so if you're just allowing this to dissipate, that's actually releasing heat, keeping Mr. Bear warm in the winter. Okay, so that's another thing. There's also used to be a diet pill called dinitrophenol, a poorly conceived diet pill. This diet pill, this molecule, could take that proton and wiggle its way through the into the matrix, right? And deposit that proton on the other side. So it's like, you know, arsenic is a diet pill, right? And so eventually people are like, why are you so pasty, dude? It's like, you know, you're just sitting there like a brown bear. You're uncoupled. You're not able to have enough ATP to make molecules, right? It makes you sick. And so this is another molecule, this FCCP, which can bind a proton and is greasy enough to just slither its way across that inner membrane and deposit this proton on the other side. So there's both a protein that can, in a gated fashion, control the transport of protons when you're hibernating, but also you can have this. Small molecules can make this journey, dissipating the gradient. So now I mentioned, what about this one more proton? So it takes four protons moved across the bilayer to make one ATP. Three to drive this camshaft around, kicking out ATP molecules. The other one is right here, right? And so you're dissipating some of this. This is a symport. Both of these are active transport. So you're moving down the gradient with the proton and up the gradient with the inorganic phosphate. And here you're transporting or transferring ADP in, right? We need both ADP and inorganic phosphate, and ATP out. Why is this using the energy of the gradient? Or is it? Is that a good quicker question? I'll just write it right now. Why? Is that using proton gradients? Look at the movement of charge. Three negative charges going out, four negative charges coming in. Four negative charges coming out, three negative charges coming in. So there's a net efflux of negative charge. Is it helpful to have this plus and the minus the way they are? That's from the movement of protons. So the movement of protons is driving. This is an energy-requiring step. So this is co-transport, and we're using just this disequilibrium of charge on the bilayer. So this is dissipating some more energy. Because we had to have this thing encapsulated in a mitochondria, we're going to have to spend some energy to get molecules moved across that bilayer. Okay, so this is the whole process. We've deposited electrons on an oxygen molecule to make water, and we've made ATP. So let's... But we have one more problem. We made an NADH molecule. And where is that? That was in glycolysis. That was in the cytosol. So we need a particularly scary pathway to get that NADH into the mitochondria. Remember, NADH on complex 1 is binding in the matrix. It's not binding in the intermembrane space. And so we have this, it gets better and better. So we have what's called the aspartate malate shuttle. And this is electron neutral. There's charged molecules moving, but if you count everything up, the number of charges moving in each direction, it's neutral, right? And so we have first, we run this enzyme in reverse. Like, dude, that's in the cytosol. Yes, there's a cytosolic version of that enzyme and a matrix version of that enzyme. So the cytosolic version, same darn enzyme you saw in the Krebs cycle. Remember, and so we're taking and running this in reverse. We're depositing this electron from NADH onto oxal acetate, taking the carbonyl to an alcohol. That malate is then transferred in. Once in, we can have the malate dehydrogenase. You know, in the Krebs cycle, we know exactly what Krebs cycle is doing. We're oxidizing, and we can transfer those electrons back onto NADH. So the way this has evolved is that the electrons take a ride on a small metabolite through into the matrix and then are released onto NADH. And now we're in the right place. Now we can use NADH in electron transport. And there's all this other complexity, so we're actually moving glutamic acid and alpha-ketoglutarate, and there's this amino transferase. We're going to see the mechanism. This is a beautiful mechanism, but it's really complicated, so we're going to skip that till a little bit later. But here we're taking this carbonyl group and converting it to an amino group. So this is aspartate acid amino acid, and that gets transported out. And so that we have... we don't want to have like net efflux of TCA metabolites. So we have sort of both of these. If you look at this process, we don't have any net efflux. Anything comes in, goes out. So it's sort of making a circle here. But the net input is NADH and the output is NADH. Okay? So this is called the aspartate malate shuttle. So this is complicated, not only to study, but it takes time for this to happen in a cell. So this type of transport occurs mostly in heart tissue and in liver. But in your muscle, when you're making a ton of NADH, you know, so when you start running a lot, you get those pains. That's lactic acid building up. But the alternate place to put those electrons are on NADH in the mitochondria. So instead of taking all this time and doing all these chemical transformations, you can literally take a syringe and inject those electrons directly into this inner membrane of the mitochondria. So there's this enzyme, mitochondrial glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, which takes a glycerol, a alcohol functionality, and oxidizes it to a carbonyl group, putting those electrons on FADH2. Now remember, succinate dehydrogenase, that was hanging out in the matrix. This guy is hanging out here. So the advantages of having it on the outer surface here is that we don't need to transport molecules at all. We could just inject those electrons directly in the form of QH2. But it's less efficient. We took NADH and we just made QH2. That we lost the transport of 4 protons, but we gain speed. So when you're running around, the lion's behind you, the bear is woken up from his slumber. I mean, you need to move fast, and you're much more efficient when you can do aerobic respiration. So in your skeletal muscle, you have this process occurring so that you can rapidly, it's not completely efficient, you're losing 4 of those protons, 1 ATP molecule per NADH, but it's still, you know, reasonably good. Okay, so these are, now let's do a whole counting of the cost where everything is. So in glycolysis, we're going to put everything together from taking our glucose and converting it to carbon dioxide. What's the total number of ATP molecules? This is often asked on tests, so pay attention. You can put a box around it if it's helpful. So in glycolysis, remember we made 2 NADHs because we split the molecule. Remember that part? So per glucose, 2 NADHs. Now, if we're skeletal muscle and the bear is like chasing me around, we're going to inject those electrons directly into the membrane. Or if, you know, the muscle, your heart just sort of dum-da-dum-da-dum, doing the same thing, very steady, then we have time to transport those electrons and get some more ATP molecules. Right, so you have 2 NADHs. For each NADH, you make either 2.5 if you fully take NADH into the matrix. Right, so making ATP, or the oxidation of NADH, moves 10 protons. Takes 4 protons to make an ATP, including the camshaft action and the transport of molecules. So for 10 into 4, that's 2.5. Per NADH molecule, we have 2 NADHs, so that comes out to 5. So you can convince yourself of that. But if we shortcut and skip those first 4 protons by injecting the electrons directly in, bare escaping muscles, then we lose an ATP molecule. You only get 1.5 ATP molecules per NADH. Of course, we've also made an ATP, and that's in the cytosol. Remember, pyruvate, we took each pyruvate molecule, made 1 NADH. We have 2 coming in from glucose, so it's 2 NADHs, 2.5 ATPs per NADH. Remember, 4 protons, 10 total are removed. And then we had, in Krebs cycle, we had, remember in the circle, it's like down here is 1, 2, 3, right, times 2, right, is 6. And that ends up, you multiply by 2.5, you get 15. FADH, we skip 4 protons again, so you got 3. And of course, you got 2 because you came in with glucose, split in 2, you got 2 pyruvates coming all the way in. Remember, there's that one step towards the bottom of the Krebs cycle where you make a GTP, and I mentioned that GTP can be interconverted between ATP and GTP. So if you sum all this together, depending on whether the lion is chasing you or not, you have 30 or 32 ATP molecules. So this is a good one to just make sure. This is an aggregation of knowledge type of slide. So look through all the previous slide. Make sure that you believe this. Okay? And so this is pretty amazing. We're capturing that energy at about 32 to 34% efficiency. The car that you might drive around, go to Walmart or whatever, that's only 30% efficient. But some of that energy was wasted to keep us warm, right? To keep us warm-blooded animals, right? And so it's even more efficient if you consider it's useful both to make ATPs and not be as cold as the room. All right, so here's some of you will be doctors, hopefully. In ischemic injury, you have like some kind of problem with your blood vessels being clogged, and that ultimately results in oxygen not being delivered to your cells. What might happen to the pH when oxygen is not delivered? What molecule would be synthesized? Lactic acid, right? So if you're not getting oxygen, it's all about glycolysis, and you get acidic. So there's this protein, and it has a transformation from a tetramer to a dimer, depending on pH. And so when the pH goes down, when your blood's not flowing, oxygen is cut off, this makes a dimer. And it's only able to bind. So this is actually the F1 subunit of two different F0, F1 ATP synthases. And in the dimer form, it literally is able to grab these two, because it's important. If you don't stop them, they'll start going in reverse and hydrolyzing ATP, right? And so that would be a bad thing. So this thing says stop is the moment the pH changes, your blood is restricted, lactic acid builds up, this thing changes into a dimer, grabs these things and say stop, and grabs the camshaft, actually. You can see here it's camshafty shaped. So this is what happens to help protect you. That way you can at least have a little bit of ATP to play around with. Okay, so something that we'll say throughout the semester is this concept of energy charge. And this is defined here with this equation. You take all possible forms of these adenylates, the triphosphate, diphosphate, and monophosphate, right? And then you look at the fraction of the forms of the molecule that are generally used in biochemical reactions. Generally, it's just ATP is used. And so here it has ATP. Okay, that's useful. And it has 1/2 ADP. And the reason it has 1/2 ADP is because there's a reaction that works close to equilibrium starting from the standard state where you can convert two ADP molecules into one ATP, useful molecule, and one AMP, not useful molecule. So you get half. So this is the amount of useful ATP equivalents in the cell. And in general, in healthy cells, this is maintained through allosteric regulation of all the enzymes in glycolysis and Krebs cycle to be about 0.9. So there's about 10-fold excess in your cells of ATP over ADP. That helps to push reactions forward because the cellular state is more exergonic. ATP hydrolysis is more exergonic because its ATP is 10-fold higher in concentration. And so this energy charge level set point is affected by the allosteric regulation occurring throughout all of these pathways. So remember, allosteric regulators bind to a site other than the active site, and that regulatory site can have whatever binding affinity it wants. And through evolution, it became useful to have a ratio of ATP to other forms of these adenylates that was about 10-1. To help push processes forward. And so all of these regulators are precisely tuned. So the flux through this pathway will maintain this charge. If you start running around, you need more flux through the pathway. If you have, you know, a big meal, you got to do something with all that energy. If you're sitting on the couch, you need to regulate this pathway. So we've now made it all the way through, and we've synthesized 30 to 32 ATP molecules. Any questions so far? This is sort of phase two of this class. There's a lot of information. So nature, we're just admiring nature's handiwork here. I didn't make it. There you go. Oh, it's full. Thanks. All right. Test. Test. All right. Everybody vote. Oh, no, yet. There's people coming through. There's collisions. It's bloody. It's just awful. Everybody vote. Did you turn it off? All right. Das Boot. Which one is it? Yeah. You guys did very well on this, so congratulations. Even when it wasn't Googleable, congratulations.